Yeah, brother, start cleaning those tires up.
Green this time, remember they fan out down there, so protect that bottom. Sunday drive.
All right, boss man, these cars off. Be ready.
Yeah, bud, be ready, gas that bitch up.
Ready, ready, green flag.
Green.
Welcome everybody to the Inside Pass. Sorry, my microphone is aww.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, Randy.
It brings a tear to my one good eye. Hold on, don't interrupt the singing. You're only 5 days early, but that's fine.
As 3 days, as 4 days,
right, whatever. As we record this live, it's 5 days, 4 days.
When this airs on SIC, we'll be a day late.
It's exactly right.
Yeah, so happy birthday, belated birthday.
Exactly, exactly. Thank you, guys.
See, what'll happen is, now somebody from SIC will hear this, and then on Monday, you'll be eligible for the spin of the wheel on home ad for the birthdays.
That is true.
You might win, like, a cake or something.
Hopefully somebody pays attention.
Talk to Shannon about that.
Yeah.
We got Mark back there. We'll let him know.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, if he's listening right now, then he'll come storming in here in a minute, hopefully with a cupcake. Anyway, so
he brings gifts.
I'm just saying.
Cup-bearing gifts.
I would accept any cupcake of any kind of flavor variety if anybody wants to bring me one.
Look, all you got from us was the birthday song, and that's because Peter told me 5 minutes before he walked in the door, so.
So at least somebody remember. Thank you, Peter.
Of course.
And, you know, full transparency.
Ten bonus points for fantasy NASCAR for you.
Oh,
as long as I'm ahead of Noah, that's all that counts.
Let's start our show. Unfortunately, we do have to start with some sad news. Some breaking news that happened earlier this afternoon. The late, great Bob Jenkins passed away today, age of 73, complications from brain cancer. And, man, you know, guy, I know Peter's still fairly young, as is Chris. They may not remember his heydays of being an announcer. I certainly do, and I know, Tom, you do as well.
Yes, sir.
Most people are going to remember him probably from his tenure as the Indianapolis 500 announcer on television. I remember him most from his days as Thursday Night Thunder announcer.
Absolutely.
For
ESPN.
The USAC Sprint Car Series that he actually created himself, along with a couple of other guys.
Larry Newbern
being one of them, and I think Larry Rice was a part of that.
Larry Rice was
too.
A part of that. And do you remember who else was a part of that?
I know. The other name slipped.
The Honorable
mind,
Dave Despain.
Yes, Dave Despain. Yeah. And I believe that Bob Jenkins actually filled in for Dave on some episodes of his Wind Tunnel show.
I think you're probably right. Again, so. Those Thunder shows were awesome. I mean, Thursday Thunder originally was kind of a rotating cast of races. Mm-hmm. When ESPN launched in 1979, Thursday Night Thunder used to have late models from the Midwest.
Yeah.
So, you know, names like Dean Roper and Bob Seneker and all the greats, Dick Trickle would race in that series. Just awesome. I mean, it was so good back then, you know, and it didn't take high-tech graphics or anything. It was just pure racing.
Well, if you look at some of the things that have happened, you know, since then, the under-the-track cameras that they use now on the Fox Network, those originally started with Thursday Night Thunder.
Yep.
That they did when they had that technology going at which is Indianapolis Raceway Park for all of you youngsters out there, which is now O'Reilly or Lucas Oil Raceway Park. Now, that's just one of the things that they done, and they kind of sort of reinvented the Thursday Night Thunder format several years ago, back when TNN was a network, the national network.
Yes.
They did a Motorsports Madness thing on Friday night that was kind of the same sort of concept with different variations of motorsports that they did on Friday night, but it never really got the same sort of, like, you know, prestigiousness that the USAC Sprint Cars got on Thursday Night Thunder. But just, I mean, if you think about who came out of that series, you know, Jeff Gordon, Tony Stewart, Ryan Newman, all those guys started on the Thursday Night Thunder series. And Peter, I don't know if you probably remember him most from the Indy 500 days, but I don't know if you've even seen any of the USAC Sprint Car races that they used to have on ESPN way back in the heyday, but those were some good time races.
Yeah, they of course were. Like you said, launch careers of Jeff Gordon, Tony Stewart, plenty of Hall of Fame drivers and talents. Of course, I remember Bob Jenkins more for what he did in NASCAR on ESPN, and then in the IndyCar, obviously, he was the voice of the Indy 500, I mean, the undisputed voice.
Yes.
I mean, until his cancer diagnosis, he missed two Indy 500s, and they were both back in the 60s. One was actually for a school trip to Washington, D.C., where instead of going to see all the sites and monuments, he stayed in the bus listening to the radio to the race to hear the 1965 Indy 500. Just that dedication shows how much the Indy 500 meant to him, and just he was just. I never got the chance to meet him or interact with him, but he just seemed like such a down-to-earth, relatable guy that will certainly be remembered by all in motorsports and dearly missed.
Hard to imagine. He got his start as an agricultural announcer at local Indianapolis radio way back in the day. So he certainly will be missed. He is one of the voices of motorsports you can't help but think about when you think about legendary figures in our sport. And so we certainly send our thoughts and prayers out to his family and
Bob Jenkins was to this generation what Chris Economaki was to the previous generation.
Yeah. Well, and again, it's the uniqueness of the voice, the passion for the sport, and just the ability to get out of the way. Yeah. You know, as a play-by-play announcer, especially when you have analysts, you know, you have to be able to, and I think Mike Joy does it so well, too, you have to be able to just move the show along and kind of be the director, and you have to have the ability to just sort of get out of the way and let your and let the race do the talking. And Bob was so good at that. Alan Bestwick is so good at that. I mean, and I love this, looking at NASCAR.com and Jenkins' quote here. You know what I tell people often when they ask me how this whole thing of my career came together? I tell them, you know, I don't know, because I've only been a race fan who got lucky, and I think that's what I will have on my tombstone, because it's true. And so, you know, that's, and I think for a lot of us who do this stuff, we're fans first.
Absolutely.
You know, and Bob just personified that so well, you know, and gosh, his loss. I mean, I feel that, you know, he's one of the people that was sort of a hero of mine as a young, you know, race fan. And, you know, when I got into the media in the late 80s, you know, Bob was someone from an announcing standpoint that I wanted to be like. You know, and gosh, those Thunder shows were amazing. You know, it's and they were so I mean, they moved that to Saturday at one point. It became Saturday Night Thunder. Do you mm-hmm. remember that, Randy?
Yep, I do.
And you know, the funny story for me is that there was a morning where we were driving from Oswego, New York to Sandusky for one of their, I think it was their cavalcade race. We got there. It rained out. We went to the mall, had a pizza, turn around, and we're back in time to watch Saturday Night Thunder. 14-hour round trip made sure we got back in time to watch Saturday Night Thunder. You know, because that's what you do. I mean, it was just that important. Didn't have VCRs then. No, you know,
Thursday Night Thunder was one of those shows where you don't want to move. You
know, no.
Like, you have to make sure that
Must
nothing is
TV.
Planned. Like, yep. You know, family outings, whatever. Like, I don't have family yep. tonight. I'm going to sit here and watch this coverage, because it was such a unique idea at the time, because it almost got as much coverage as NASCAR was at the time, because I think for a while NASCAR was actually on ESPN too.
It was.
And they put more emphasis on plugging that programming for Thursday Night Thunder with the USAC Sprints than they did on the NASCAR coverage. It was, the ratings were pretty comparable for a while. I mean, you know, everybody was tuning in to see these guys race. And, you know, looking at it now, I mean, obviously this is the oldest generation of NASCAR drivers now. I mean, guys like Gordon have now gone on to do other things. But
right.
You look at this generation now, you know, Peter and everybody thinks, you know, Christopher Bell, Kyle Larson, you know, guys like that. But if it wasn't for guys like Jeff Gordon and, you know, the Thursday Night Thunder.
Tony Stewart.
Yeah, Tony Stewart and guys like that, even Ryan Newman to a extent.
Casey King.
Toward the end. If it wasn't for guys like that and the Thursday Night Thunder, you know, idea that was put forth by Bob Jenkins to ESPN, who knows where these guys would be today.
Absolutely. Thursday Night Thunder was pivotal in the trajectory of motorsports on TV and helped bring not just awareness to the big time series like NASCAR or IndyCar, but grassroots racing as well. I mean, I don't think we'd see the popularity of series like IROC or SRX without Thursday Night Thunder.
Well, the other, that's, again, it was very much of its time, because, you know, there wasn't all this, we didn't have internet, we didn't have, you know, live streaming, it was very rare to see racing on TV. So, and especially live racing in prime time, that's ESPN lost a great deal of their soul when they started getting all of the pro leagues and just kind of going, because what made them when they first started was they weren't afraid to do the lower tier college leagues and you know, short track racing and all of that. It was very pure back then.
Well, it's kind of like what happens with Speed Channel. You know, everybody loved Speed Channel because they could pretty much put whatever racing they wanted to on the Speed Channel, and you got to see a lot of the regional action and a lot of the, you know, grassroots type of racing, you know, ARCA and things like that that you don't get to see now because now, you know, you look at the ARCA series and sometimes it's on Peacock, sometimes it's on Track Pass, sometimes it's on, you know, regular, you know, NBC, but FS1. 6 months after it, you know, airs or whatever the case may be. So there's not that opportunity anymore to see the USAC guys in action. I mean, MAV TV is pretty much the only place to see them now, and even then, they show them on a tape delay, I think, so... there's just no real place.
Well,
to
it's easy with live stream now. Everything's digitized, but it's just I mean, Bob Jenkins really was a pioneer to me, and you know, and again, somebody who carried himself with a great deal of class, who really was just passionate about the sport, and that's how he broadcasted.
So. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention one of his last broadcasts was an iRacing event last summer that Noah actually won in IndyCars at Indianapolis Motor Speedway. So that's certainly a moment that Noah will carry with him for the rest of his life.
That is absolutely true.
Yeah, definitely. Yep. All right, so we are going to step aside here and take a break in just a little bit. We have a lot of other things to talk about, a lot of other things to cover tonight, including the Truck Series playoffs, the races at Watkins Glen, and a fantastic race at Nashville. With the IndyCar series that we'll talk about as well. Some news out of the world of Outlaws, too, with a huge suspension and fines levied down there, too. And the Knoxville Nationals entry list. Knoxville Nationals are coming up this weekend. There are 122 entries right now for the Knoxville Nationals. So we'll break down some of those drivers as well. We are going to take a break. We'll be back with more of the Inside Pass right after this. Stick with us. We will be right back.
Do you love the sound of high revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skills levels, new to intermediates, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
Victory Custom Trailers is the place to go for your next new or used trailer or coach. Being personally involved in the racing community allows Victory to fully understand what racers need in a trailer. They have over 200 coaches and trailers in stock for a variety of industries, and they can serve anyone in the continental U.S. If you're looking for something custom, they can assist in designing a trailer to fit your needs. Check out their entire inventory online at victorycustomtrailers.com.
I'm Andrew Saul, Commissioner of Social Security. Beware of telephone scammers pretending to be government employees. Real Social Security employees will never threaten you. Call us threatening you with arrest or other legal action and demanding money are not from us. If you receive a call like this, hang up, do not provide them with any form of payment or information. Report the call at oig.ssa.gov.
What an awesome game. What's up with your car? I don't know. It won't start. How are we getting home?
Chill. My parents signed me up for the roadside assistance from Lewis Meineke. It was free with my oil change. They would come and get the car started or get us home and tow the car to the shop.
Good to know. With my driving, my parents never know what to expect.
When you join the Meineke Car Care Club with a $35 preferred service, you get 4 free months of roadside assistance, including tire change, battery jump, lockout service, towing, and more. Contact Lewis Meineke, located on Route 1, or call 827-2054.
When do you think of a plumber? like most people. Even if it's an emergency, you can be confident about who will arrive to help you. For quality and reliability, count on someone you can trust. Call on the plumbing services of Hague Quality Water of Maryland. Plumbing doesn't have to be an emergency. We handle all kinds of preventative maintenance too. Hague Quality Water of Maryland is family owned here in Annapolis since 1993. For a refreshing choice, call us at 888-84-WATER or visit us online.
This is Justin Lawson, and you're listening to the best guys on the radio, The Inside Guys.
We're not going to talk about one Ramblin' Man. We're going to talk about 10, and they all drive trucks. The NASCAR playoffs for the Truck Series officially begins, well, not this week, because they're not racing this week. They actually begin in like four.
Or next week.
I was going to say.
Well, no, week after that.
It's not
Labor
this
Day
weekend.
Weekend.
It's 3 weeks, right? It's like the
no, August. No, it's not this weekend. It's next weekend.
Okay. So it's like the 18th or 19th or something like that, because they're running Gateway in a couple of weeks.
Oh,
so.
That's right. Yeah.
So we got to wait a couple weeks for the playoffs to officially start, but we do have our 10 drivers who will make up the playoffs, and so I thought maybe we would kind of take a look at the 10 drivers who made the playoffs, and I don't think there's any real surprises there. The 10 drivers that were there in the beginning are the 10 that made the playoffs. John Hunter Nemechek, of course, won the regular season championship for the Truck Series, so he gets a hefty little 15-point bonus that he don't need to go into the next round of the playoffs. But Austin Hill, Ben Rhodes, Todd Gilliland, Sheldon Creed, Zane Smith, Matt Crafton, Carson Hocevar, Chandler Smith, and Stuart Friesen are the 10 drivers that make up the Camping World Truck Series Championship standings as we head into Gateway. Peter, any surprises?
Not really. I mean, I'm really surprised that only half these drivers have at least one win this season. That's partly due to John Hunter Nemechek and Kyle Busch following up so many wins earlier in the year, but it's interesting to see how Nemechek is so far ahead in points with nearly 2,050 points, and everyone else, no one has more than 2,021 points, so it's really looks like a one-horse race, but ultimately four do make the championship four in Phoenix, so who will the other three be?
Nine would be a good time to have another baby, because then you could take a couple weeks off and still be okay. not that he wants another baby right now, I'm just saying. Like, if he needed to take a break, he could certainly do that. But, I mean, Tommy, if you look at the list, every year we talk about the playoffs, we always talk about the need to win races, and you want to get that win out of the way, get on to the next round without having to worry about, getting behind or having that mulligan that doesn't really exist when you talk about how competitive these guys are on the racetrack. But, as Peter said, five of the 10 drivers have won a race this year. I guess the other five races or the other, eight races, however many it was, some of them were won by Kyle Busch and some of his cohorts in the 54 truck. But you look at that list of the guys who haven't won this year that need to win to continue on in the standings. Who among those bottom five do you think could possibly get that win out of the way early and then be able to make it to the next round?
I would have to say right now that Chandler Smith probably strikes me as being the one most likely.
He's done everything but win.
But Carson Hocevar is also another driver that could be a threat in the playoffs. It's interesting to me that, you talk about, are there any surprises? To me, Stuart Friesen's a major surprise because really Stuart, he kind of limped in. He's only led 14 laps all year. He's had three DNFs. He's only had four top tens, three top fives. I mean, he barely made it into the playoffs. I think that Zane Smith getting in is quite intriguing because I think Zane's another one that could be dangerous down the stretch. But there's so many of these drivers here that to me, there's like a clear distinction between the top five and the bottom five
in the playoffs.
I mean, like, I feel like there's not 10 drivers to me that can win the championship. I think there's five guys that can win the championship. Maybe you throw Crafton in there because he's done it. But I think there's a clear distinction this year, and I really believe that the championship race itself is going to be won by one of those guys in the top five. I just don't see an upset.
Peter?
I mean, I can't disagree, but just think back 2 years ago, Matt Crafton shocked the world and won the title without having to win the final race and without winning a race all season long. So we've seen this whole system upended before in recent history. Yep. So truly, there are still, in essence, 10 contenders.
Well, let's talk about how we got here. Obviously, the trucks went to Watkins Glen for the first time in 21 years and competed on the road course at Watkins Glen. What did you guys think about the race, Tom?
I actually thought that the race was okay. I didn't think it was fantastic. It was okay. It was unfortunate that it ended early because of the lightning rule, but obviously there's a safety aspect to that that you don't want to tamper with. So it was all right. I expected better, honestly, for the first time being on the course. For most of these guys, I thought it would be a little bit more of a dogfight all the way through than I thought it turned out to be, but it was okay. I mean, it was a good race.
Peter?
I was surprised at the initial start how Nemechek tried to go bowling into turn one. I mean, he took go bowling at the Glen literally with a couple of his teammates there.
It was a couple days early on that race.
I'm still of the opinion that NASCAR needs to figure out a way, talk to your TV partners or something to start these races earlier, because the only reason why the Truck Series race got canned at the end is so they could hit their Xfinity Series start time on time with time to prep. So, I mean, you got all this time throughout the day. Rearrange something on FS1. You know, they did an hour of race day coverage right up until the start of the
ARCA race. The ARCA race. Yeah, the ARCA race.
You know, they do all this race day stuff. You know, figure it out. Race day, make it 30 minutes. I don't care what you do, but there's no reason why we should be ending races. It's just like what happened at New Hampshire when they killed it 10 laps early because of the daylight. There's no reason why we should be, you know, cutting time on races because of time.
Yeah, to me, you know, you and I see promoters do it. Look, local track promoters do it. You know, the short track promoters that run 7, 8, 9 divisions in a night and then, you know, wonder why you're there till 2 in the morning. It's because you just put too much on the schedule. There's got to be some wiggle room here for weather. I mean, Watkins Glen is a high chance. That track and Pocono both, very high probabilities of rain just because of where they are. I just think, again, like Chris said, we've got to be able to adjust broadcast times. I thought the ARCA race always started at 5. I was very surprised that they thought it was a good idea to do an hour of race day and start the thing at 6 when you know that it really starts to get dark about 8 o'clock. And it's an ARCA race. You're probably going to have some cautions. And I don't say that being derogatory. It's just it's a developmental series. So you're going to have some issues. I agree. I think that NASCAR needs to really look at that. I understand they're trying to hit the TV audience. I know Fox has a say, but it's like, come on, guys. I mean, you know,
right, especially when there's weather,
common sense
when you know weather's going to play a factor in your timing or whatever. But like Chris said, I mean, you don't really need an hour of race day coverage. If you're going to have an hour of race day coverage, then why don't you do the pre-race show during race day and kill kind of two birds?
Right.
Because if you think about, race day's on for an hour, and then the coverage starts at, you know, 3 Eastern or whatever, and you have 45. The green flag did not happen on the truck race till 3:48 p.m.
And that's what happened with the ARCA race as well. They did an hour of race day, then they tossed it to Jamie Little, and then they messed around for half an hour, and they didn't go green till like 6:45.
Yeah.
And it's already 7 at that point, and it's going to, especially with the elevation changes at that track, you're going uphill, downhill. You know, sun's going to hit different spots. It's going to be darker and different. Figure it out.
Yeah. You know, you're wasting another 45 minutes on top of the hour you already wasted when you could have just taken the green flag and had the race over it.
Yeah, I don't know. It's frustrating to me sometimes the way
I felt
bad
for IndyCar on Sunday, too, because the Cup race ran a little long and then they were delayed and they had a question of daylight towards the end of the IndyCar race too. So I think it's a mixture of not starting early enough. I mean, they didn't even start the Cup race until 3 on a Sunday. I mean, I get church crowd and all that stuff, but 1:30, 2 o'clock. Yeah. You know, an hour saves a lot of time.
Well, yeah,
And it's just unnecessary.
I mean, if you think about, like, you know, race day, let's say, if NASCAR's thinking, okay, we have to wait for the start because of, you know, the time frame,
the West Coast audience, right, they say is their biggest.
But if people are tuning into race day, chances are they're going to watch the race. So it's okay for you to, you know, to pull the start of the race a little bit forward.
Before the Xfinity race on Saturday, they were playing an episode of Dale Jr. Download.
Yeah.
Like, why? Yeah. It's already aired.
See, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. I think you just, you know, again, for me, I would love to go back to the, you know, and we can't, obviously, but it would be interesting to go back and research what the West Coast audience portion of the ratings were like back in the days when the races used to start at noon or 1 o'clock. So it'd be, you know, 9 or 10 out there. I never heard any West Coast people complain because they had to have breakfast while they were watching the Cup race. I don't know that that was ever an issue.
And shoot, when you're cutting the race because it's getting too dark out, what are you doing? You know, where are you losing?
I was going to say, especially at tracks where there's no lights, I think you just got it. And the irony is, you know what time the Cup race at Indy starts Sunday? 1 o'clock.
I think it's crazy to me that tracks
and they have lights there.
I think it's crazy to me that tracks like New Hampshire don't have lights yet. Like, get with the times.
Well, the issue with New Hampshire, I believe, is a county ordinance where they can't have lights. I think when they built that track, said they can't race anything at night, so they never put lights in there. I think the same is true with Dover, with them being near the Air Force Base.
I'm kind of interested about.
I could appreciate Dover, but
I'm kind of interested about the whole, you know, what the numbers look like on the West Coast before, you know, we started going to 3 p.m. start times, because I figure everybody on the West Coast probably has an opportunity to get holy at this point. Now
it goes back to what Junior said. It goes back to what Junior said on the Download. You don't see different start times in any other sport other than. Than NASCAR.
Like football, this
football starts at the same time. NBA starts at the same time. Yeah. MLB, you'll see the series of games of MLB. Just tell everybody, tough, race starts at 1.
Exactly.
You know, there we go.
Set your alarm clock and get up if you really want to go to the race.
I mean, again, I just never knew. I mean, Indy starts at like 11 every year, the 500. It's like, I don't hear anybody from the West Coast screaming about that.
No, people will be cooking eggs or listening to the Indy 500.
Well, I guess it depends on where on the West Coast you are. They're cooking something. But it's probably not eggs. I'm just saying. Anyway.
I just needed an excuse to hit the buzzer.
That's why they all need to go to church, and that's why they all want the races to start at 3 o'clock so they can all get holy again.
It is what it is. I just feel like you're not leaving very much room for situational things to occur when you start a race that late, especially on a track with the lights.
Yep, that's for sure. All right, we're going to take a break. We'll come back, talk about Xfinity Cup and IndyCar when we come back. More Inside Pass right around the turn. Stick with us. We'll be right back.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Automotive technicians and auto service trainees, how would you like to work at the beach and perform for one of the best car care centers in the nation? Louis Meineke is now looking for skilled automotive technicians to join their award-winning team. If you're a gearhead that knows his or her stuff, or a young up-and-comer that has the motivation and drive to succeed, then you need to make this call today. 302-827-2054. Louis Meineke Car Care Center, located in beautiful Lewis, Delaware, offers a highly competitive compensation plan, great benefits, a flexible schedule, and did we mention that you're going to be working at the beach? Plus, there's a signing bonus for the right candidates. Technicians must be ASE certified and have a minimum of 6 years' experience. Beginners, advance at your own pace in one of several entry-level positions. But whatever you do, don't wait. These jobs will go fast. Call Tim at 302-827-2054. That's 302-827-2054. Louis Meineke Car Care Center. Rev up your career.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Victory Custom Trailers is the place to go for your next new or used trailer or coach. Being personally involved in the racing community allows Victory to fully understand what racers need in a trailer. They have over 200 coaches and trailers in stock for a variety of industries, and they can serve anyone in the continental U.S. If you're looking for something custom, they can assist in designing a trailer to fit your needs. Check out their entire inventory online at victorycustomtrailers.com.
He wanted to be known for doing his best.
Shoot it right.
His best made him Major League Baseball's most valuable player.
Strike two.
He played in 6 World Series and was elected to the Hall of Fame. Oh. Although an honest man, he was best at stealing home.
Save.
But the best quality of Jackie Robinson's life was his character. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. Thanks for passing it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
I'm Matt DiBenedetto, the brutally honest NASCAR driver, and you're listening to the Inside Pass.
I like how it's, think about this, honest Abe, brutally honest Matt. Like,
we do have some news with Matt DiBenedetto too. He basically everybody's been asking him about the rumor mill lately, and he basically said, "Look, guys, I'll consider anything for 2022." So there you go.
Which leads me to believe there's more to it than just that.
And then like,
if I know Matt the way I know Matt, he's talking to somebody somewhere about.
I hope so.
So you think that by saying that he's just sort of
getting him off of his back.
Yeah, getting basically. Everybody off his back for a little bit. Yeah. Okay.
He got a top 10 yesterday.
He did.
He did finish 10th. So
teams run better since they've swapped crew chiefs.
Not that they're going to regret kicking him out of the car, but, you know, we can all hope for
that. Too little too late in that
too little
crew chief change.
Exactly. Well, somebody who doesn't have to worry about being kicked out anytime soon is Ty Gibbs. Ty won again, this time in the Xfinity Series, though.
I'm mad at Joe Gibbs Racing.
Why?
I'm
just curious.
I can't wait to hear this.
I'm sure there's a story to this.
They did this big tease for 2 days with a silhouetted driver.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
In the background, which Ty posted 3 days earlier, the photo shoot, and everybody thought, oh, it's going to be Ty Gibbs announced for the 20 car and Xfinity in 2022. No, it's just a Sports Clips announcement. Like, why? Who cares? Get your hair cut, you know?
It got you to look at it, didn't it?
They used a quote Kyle Busch had in a press conference recently saying Ty Gibbs should have sports clothes because he has a good hair, unlike
his dad. Does that make
it
okay?
Kyle Busch joke I thought was pretty creative.
I just laughed at how many people thought it was John Hunter Nemechek.
Yeah, I was like, how?
I knew it was Ty.
No.
Like,
I took 2 pictures and said, yeah, that's John Hunter. Cool.
Well, I mean, I'm sure there's probably something coming later down the road, but I mean,
you thought it was John Hunter, didn't you?
No, I did not. I knew it was Ty. I mean, why would it be John Hunter? He's got the little like foofy thing on the side of his head.
Yeah,
the little floofy thing. Whatever it is. Obviously, I'm not a hairdresser for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
So I would not know what that's called. Nor do I have the hair to make that happen.
I had a 5 head when I was 4.
Yeah. Peter, try not to laugh.
I agree with Chris though. That was we're giving JGR a buzzer for
dumb.
That because that was weak.
You could have done the clip with the paint scheme. You didn't need a whole photo shoot for.
Well, I think somebody just didn't.
Somebody
didn't
was bored.
Well, either that or
they had 2 weeks off, so they didn't know what to do.
Forgot to tell Ty, don't post these pictures until Saturday morning because we've got this announcement coming up. They're going to ruin the surprise, but. I mean, I guess if you don't follow Ty Gibbs, clearly the people that thought it was John Hunter Nemechek don't follow Ty Gibbs, or else they would have seen the pictures ahead of time.
I know.
I'm just saying.
That was crazy.
Also,
I know they're both blondes, but come on.
To give JGR some credit, they did do something pretty funny on.
So now you're going to give them credit after you just dissed them for.
You got
to be fair and balanced.
Pros and cons.
50-50.
Pros and cons. They did this cool design for social media where they took Ty's burnout from Watkins Glen and they replaced the, you know, the NY Hart or...
I Love New York. Yeah, I Heart New York.
It's
yeah.
Ty Hart New York.
Yeah, that's clever.
Yeah.
Wow. And somebody got a bonus for that, too.
See, I'm old enough to remember when that campaign debuted. That's how old I am.
Smart, which they... I didn't unmute
myself. He cut his own mic off. At least he's fair about it.
If JGR was smart, which they did the sports clips announcement, so I can't give him too much credit. if they were smart, they would make that a T-shirt.
Yeah,
Ty Hart.
Ty Hart. At least
and have him wear it when they actually make the, you know, the actual, you know, real announcement.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it's going to depend on how long it took them to come up with that campaign, because then JGR is going to be calling and wanting you to come help them with campaign announcements.
Would be interesting if they may not be able to do that, because it may actually be trademarked so that they probably
can't. There's always that saying change a letter so it's not plagiarism, you know.
Yeah.
You can get away with it.
True. All right, well, let's go on and talk about the Cup Series, because, you know, Tom's been talking the last several weeks about how Carlosson hasn't won in a while. Well, Kyle heard you, Tom, and decided to win. So he went and won Watkins Glen.
Only because his teammate did everything in his power to lose that race.
He did. He ended up finishing second, even after getting a penalty for the 53rd time this year.
I mean...
The same penalty, by
also,
the way,
for
the 53rd time this
year. Can we talk about the double L1 penalties that's happened within the last, like, 30 days?
So when does a double become, like, a triple or
a
quadruple?
Yeah, when is there a harsher penalty? I mean, you got two L1 penalties. When do you start getting the?
Because I always thought
because obviously, you know, sending Allen on the plane home early doesn't really change anything.
Obviously, so. He's not needed anymore, so we don't really need.
Well, but in today's technological world, it doesn't matter where the crew chief is sitting. You can text. You can
FaceTime.
I mean,
for all we know, Allen could have went to the spotter stand somewhere, because all the rule says is he's ejected from the infield.
He's so hiding in the.
He's not allowed to go anywhere. You need hard card access.
He's chilling out in Chase's bus.
He'll take Rick's checkbook and just buy a suite and then have his radio. And,
probably out hiding in Bowman's Tahoe in the parking lot.
Yeah, that one was...
I think if you're gonna do that, I mean, it was Bell and Elliot, which had an issue with the shark fin, which is the little tiny piece on the top of the car, aerodynamic piece. One, what are you doing? You're tilting it? What are you doing? Like... How do you get an advantage from moving
Chris,
the
Chris just became a New Yorker in that.
What are you doing?
Tom, you're already from New York. You don't have to do the accent.
Well, it's not. See, everybody says I have
it's
a New York
for
accent.
Him, he didn't even try.
I don't talk like this. It's like I don't have a New York accent.
I don't have one.
But anyways, I just don't. Here's
the
thing.
Thing's so the piece is so small. What are you doing?
I'm sure. I'm sure that. Chris has the bell over there. I will give him a bell for that.
It's like two feet long.
It probably does affect downforce in some sort of way. And the thing is, but my thing is, it's like, why would you be that obvious? It's like when Harvick had that rear window thing. It was like you could see it by like, come on. Like this
it comes from the people that put the engine in the wrong car. Like they, how?
Yeah,
what are you doing?
Chad was better. Chad was a better cheater when he was a crew chief. He's not.
Yeah, what they should do is
he's lost his touch.
They need to suspend Chad from racing operations every time Chase gets an L1 penalty.
Well, if he's in charge of the entire, like, he was cheating all the time when he was Jimmy's crew chief, and now he's off over all four cars. How come he can only make Chase cheat?
And now he's walking through the garage. Let me turn this shark fin 90 degrees.
He has four cars to take care of, but it's always Chase that gets disqualified.
It's crazy.
You know, you need to spread the love to the other three guys.
Well, for the longest time, remember, Chase was the car that was not performing the most. It was like he was the fourth best car at Hendrick for the first half of the season. So if you're gonna cheat with a car, might as well be.
Which doesn't mean he was bad.
He helped him too much.
The other three were pretty darn good. But yeah, it's just crazy. And then Bell, same deal. And again, it's like
I don't get it. The
exterior
piece is so small.
Stuff.
I mean, I didn't think that piece moved. I thought it just came with the chassis.
Maybe Chad was like chatting with Chase, like by Chris's car, and accidentally like got to accidentally knocked it or something.
He got
skew.
He got angry because he was hit with the L1, so he just went to Christopher and punched the crap out of him.
He's mad.
He's mad.
So speaking of Kyle Larson, he now holds a 1-point advantage over
they're
Denny
tied.
Hamlin. Oh, they're tied?
They're tied.
I thought there was 1 point difference. All right. No. Well, okay, then they're tied going into the final three races.
It'll be a Kyle Larson lead after this weekend because Denny Hamlin's just out to lunch this year.
Here's the interesting thing, and I know we're going to go to break in a second, but the interesting thing about this is should Kyle take the lead and actually, which I'm assuming he actually has a tiebreaker anyways.
He does.
Because he has wins. So as of right now, if the playoffs started today, Denny would be 15th, right, in mm-hmm. the standings, as opposed to being number one.
Yeah.
Also,
so
at this
he
point,
risks not making the playoffs at all.
At this point, there is no longer a chance for 16 different winners, right?
No, there's still three races.
So there is still a chance that Denny Hamlin could win the regular season and miss the playoffs.
If you win the regular season, regardless, you're in.
You just don't get to the finals, but you're in the playoffs. There's no guarantee you're going to make the final four.
Yeah. I mean, he's been sitting pretty all season long until Kyle came along and all of a sudden kicked him
out
of the number
one
spot.
He'd take his trophy home and make it one more round, and then he'd be done.
Yes, pretty much. Yeah, that's exactly how that would work. So we'll keep an eye on that situation as it pertains to him and Kyle Larson and their quest for the regular season championship as we go further into the season. One more note before we go to a break. Ross Chastain has been officially tabbed to drive the number one for Trackhouse next year, so he will be teammates with Daniel Suarez over at the Trackhouse team. So that's one less ride that somebody can pick up. But from what I understand, Ross basically just went in the office and said, I want that ride. And Justin Marks like, okay, it's yours.
I suspect there was a little more to it than
that. Yes, but I like that story better.
They announced this on National Watermelon Day, too, which I'm sure they didn't plan, but I still love that.
Oh, I'm sure they did. I'm sure somebody didn't think about it until that day and went, hey, by the way, it's National Watermelon Day. You should probably go out there. But good for Ross. I mean, you know, he gets to stay within the organization, and he's been doing better lately and getting some consistency going. So
he'll be able to give Justin the tour of the new building. Because Justin
hasn't ever been on the building before. He's been in the building in the last 10
raced,
years.
He raced for him.
But good for us, Justine, on that as well. So when we come back from break, we're going to do Fantasy NASCAR. We're also going to talk about the IndyCar race at Nashville because that was a wild race too, which saw the winner actually rocket to the front, literally, at one point in time during the race. But a fantastic course, kind of a weird race, but some uniqueness to the race.
He literally
as well.
Jumped a car and
he
still won.
He literally did. He jumped the
car. The stadium truck race was the day before. Did he miss the memo?
He maybe thought he was in a stadium truck. And then some news out of the world of Outlaws, too, that we want to get to before we end the show today. So we are going to step aside, take a break, and then when we come back, we'll talk about that fantastic IndyCar race. If you missed it, you got to YouTube some of the action from it. Just look at the highlights, and you'll see that it was well worth it.
I don't know if fantastic is the word I would use.
Okay, well, whatever. Anyway, we'll take a break. We'll be back. Don't kill my mood. We'll be back in a minute.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Automotive technicians and auto service trainees, how would you like to work at the beach and perform for one of the best car care centers in the nation? Lewis Meineke is now looking for skilled automotive technicians to join their award-winning team. If you're a gearhead that knows his or her stuff, or a young up-and-comer that has the motivation and drive to succeed, then you need to make this call today. 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center, located in beautiful Lewis, Delaware, offers a highly competitive compensation plan, great benefits, a flexible schedule, and did we mention that you're going to be working at the beach? Plus, there's a signing bonus for the right candidates. Technicians must be ASE certified and have a minimum of 6 years experience. Beginners advance at your own pace in one of several entry-level positions. But whatever you do, don't wait. These jobs will go fast. Call Tim at 302-827-2054. That's 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center. Rev up your career.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes. On Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
He wanted to be known for doing his best.
Sure, right.
His best made him Major League Baseball's most valuable player.
Strike two.
He played in 6 World Series and was elected to the Hall of Fame. Oh. Although an honest man, he was best at stealing home.
Save.
But the best quality of Jackie Robinson's life was his character. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. Thanks for passing it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at Values.com.
When Marlon Shirley was 5 years old, he was in an accident and lost his foot, but he didn't lose his heart.
When you tackle a challenge that you just cannot even fathom tackling, when you accomplish that, the amount of integrity and the will and the heart that you'll get from that experience is what will set you up for your life.
In less time than it took Marlon Shirley to say that, he can now run 100 meters because today he's the world's fastest amputee. Overcome. Pass it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at Values.com.
Hi, I'm Mark Lynette. You're not making it work on the outside. Make sure you listen to the inside pass.
In order to avoid any awkwardness in my math, I decided to do math before we came back from commercial break. So
Mike Lynette gets a bye, right?
Like, yeah, he does have a playoff.
Yeah,
waiver.
He just has to finish in the top
12.
Yeah.
And he's still 12th in points.
So where did he finish anyways?
Once he got a top.
Because I know the NASCAR showed, NBC's coverage showed he was walking across the garage area with a cane.
He finished 11th.
Well, that's not too bad.
He had a cane?
Yeah, he walked from the garage area to his car with a cane because he still can't walk. He can't put all of his weight on his foot yet, so he was walking around with a cane.
Well, hey, he grew up playing hockey, so I'm sure he's in enough shape to get back to full health soon.
The cane was more for the competition than for him. In case he had to get into a scuffle, he'd have a weapon of choice. All right,
no, it's his social distancing stick. He can just pull it up and push people
that's
away.
6 feet, stay away from me. So Fantasy NASCAR, this week we're going to be at Indy, the Indy Road Course, for the second straight road course race. For the Xfinity and the Cup Series, the trucks are moonlighting again for another month or so. A couple weeks, they'll be back at Gateway. So the standings currently right now, I have a 35-point lead over Noah. Noah has a 121-point lead over Peter, who is 16 points above Tom. Tom is 2 points above Seth. Seth is 88 above Chris, and then Nick doesn't matter. So let's go on. No, I'm just kidding. I didn't calculate all
over
Nick.
Did Nick run out
Nick
of money?
Nick is on the Nick is broke, officially bankrupt, and now he set up a GoFundMe for money to make his way into the playoffs. He's on the verge of not making the playoffs because in 3 weeks we only take the top six. So if he doesn't make it to out of the gutter, he will not be playing with us. He'll just go back to racing more iRaces instead.
He is about 80 points, roughly, behind Chris.
Okay, well, there you go. And keep in mind,
below the cut line,
Chris started like 6 weeks after everybody else.
I know.
And still made
I'm
it up there. So yeah, he's just that good. So all right. So this week we'll just do it in some random order because I really don't want to do it in the right order that we did it before. So I'll do Peter first this time. So we'll just go like at a X or something. I don't know. I'll figure it out. Anyway, Peter, what are your choices for races this weekend?
For Xfinity on the Indy Road Course, I'll go Allmendinger because he should have won this race last year but didn't. And then Cup. I really want to pick Elliott, but I'm not. Yeah, I'll just go Elliott. That's a safe bet on road courses.
I think I know what he was about to say, but we'll see what we say later. All right, Tom, you go next.
Well, for Xfinity, since Peter picked Allmendinger and He's ahead of me. I need to do something different because I'll never catch him if I keep picking the same guys. So Austin Cindric, please. And in the Cup Series, I know a good thing when I see it. So Kyle Larson.
All right, Chris.
Ooh, let's see.
Is Ty Gibbs running the 54?
He is. I'll tell you here in just a second.
I believe he is.
Because, boy, I'll tell you
Ty
what.
Ty Gibbs is running the 54, so I am going to take Ty Gibbs.
See?
And then in the Cup Series, I am going to take Austin Cindric in his final start for Penske this year.
Mm, those are good picks. All right, I'm going to go AJ in the Xfinity Series because, like Peter said, he should have won this race last year. And I don't really know how you can bet against Kyle Larson right now because anytime we think about, you know, Chase Elliott winning the road course, it's Larson that wins it instead. So I'm going to just strike while the iron's hot. So we'll go with those two drivers for our picks. We'll get to Noah and Seth and Nick somewhere down the road. But we'll keep an eye on fantasy as we go along. So we've got about 5 minutes left.
If my math is correct, Noah should be back in 2 weeks.
That's right.
Hey.
Negative 50. No, I'm just kidding. I want to talk about IndyCar real quick. I want to get to both, but we may not get to both. But I want to talk about the IndyCar race. What did you guys think about the first race in Nashville? I thought the track was way too narrow for my liking, but I mean maybe that's just me, and maybe it was wider than it looked on TV. But to me, it looked like I could lay down on the track and block the entire racetrack, which clearly we saw that happen. So,
if your name was Colton Herta, you seemed to be able to pass just fine, but nobody else could. So I don't know. I was disappointed in the race overall. I thought the track would be a lot better. The bridge I thought was awesome. That was a lot of fun, but you know, again, way too many tight corners and, just not, you know, a tremendous opportunity here to pass. I thought some of these guys were way too aggressive coming across
the finish line to that big open area with like 10 lanes, just seeing them all like funnel out there was amazing.
Yeah. That part was cool, but you know, I don't know. I know they'll probably make a few changes for next year. I'm going to give them a pass just because it was year one. So you got to start somewhere.
Fair enough.
I'll mostly echo Tom's sentiments. I mean, no inaugural event on a new course goes perfectly. We saw this with the Charlotte Roval. They made some changes from year one to year two with that track, reworking the chicane and some barriers and so on. So overall, I'd give this event maybe a B or a B minus. Sure, they could widen a couple corners, reposition some barriers and walls, but overall I thought it was a great race, minus everyone deciding to go stupid at the start, including Marcus Ericsson trying to get a pilot's license. But overall, the second half of this race was better than the first half, and I'm excited to see it next year. I hope to be able to go next year.
Yeah, they had a good capacity crowd. It was a pretty scenic, you know, just the scenery around Nashville and the whole hype around the festivities.
I love that there were more fans in Nissan Stadium for the IndyCar race than there's ever been for a Titans game.
Yeah, really.
It's very true. It's very true. At least there's something happening at Nissan Stadium that somebody won.
More fans
the
in
that
Nashville, that's
wasn't
for sure.
A Tennessee team. So before we get out of here, I do want to mention one other news of note. The World of Outlaws had a huge fine and suspension that happened last week. Aaron Reitzel was suspended. He drives for Roth Motorsports in the 83 entry. The team got suspended. He got fined $10,000 and suspended 30 days, which means he will miss the Knoxville Nationals, which is the biggest paying event in sprint car racing all season long, because they essentially tried to tamper with the chassis. So the chassis are inspected by the World of Outlaws sanctioning body before they are turned over to the team for them to build their cars, and they essentially took a old chassis or an unapproved chassis and tried to take the sticker off of one chassis and put it on that chassis to run a race, which is a major no-no, and they were caught. And so now there will
sounds
be
like
other
something
drivers.
Chad Knauss would try.
Yeah.
he drove over to the World of Outlaws offices and went through some of the garages, I guess.
Again, they're going to find out. If you're going to cheat, do it right, for crying out loud.
That is true. That's a hefty fine, though, $10,000 and a 30-day suspension. And then, as I mentioned, you know, the World of Outlaws, the biggest race of their season is coming up this weekend, the 60th Knoxville Nationals. It was 110.
Trust me, it'll be better than the truck race that was there like a month ago.
Probably so. 110 entries. Larson's in it. Bell's in it. I'm sure there's other NASCAR drivers. Alex Bowman, I think, has actually entered in it too. So a lot of those guys are going to be down there running the race. It's Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night.
I love Bowman's paint scheme for his sprint car, the 55 Ally car. It looks really
nice. Cool. It's a really cool
paint scheme. If they make that a diecast, I'll get that diecast.
He's done half decent in the sprint car, too. He finished fifth his first time in the sprint car. So.
Yeah, people forget Alex had a background in some of that stuff. This is not, you know, new thing for Alex.
Well, he's also ran the Chili Bowl the last couple of years too. So, and he owns a midget team too. So, I mean, it's not like he's not done any of this before. It's
right.
Just, you know, he's been hanging out with Kyle Larson too much is what it is. And so Kyle's got him into the sprint car.
No, it's just Hendrick wouldn't let him do it until Kyle Larson came along.
Pretty much. He had to rework everybody's contract now because Alex just signed a new contract. So I'm sure in that contract it was like, hey, Kyle gets to race. I want to race too. So, and then Chase has run some USAC sprint car races too. So I guess it's now a thing where Kyle just busted the door at the Kool-Aid man. Suddenly everybody wants to be a sprint car driver. So
meanwhile, William Bowman went to the Midwest and ran a late model race, so he's staying.
William's going to stay with iRacing. All right, we are out of time. We'll see you guys next week. Have a great week, everybody, and we'll see you next time on the NCPS.